Slap in the bass, man. Slap in the bass.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning, Dave.
I see you're already doing your meet and greet, so if you want to continue with that and then join us in, we're going to start worship here, too. So if you want to find a seat, and we're going to sing Your Grace is Enough.
You got to sit over there. And they'll pick you off stage.
You do it.
Remember your people. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Is that you? Somebody said hello back there. Well, I am super confident that everybody in here the whole month of July memorized their memory verse for July, because today is the day we all get to say it, right? If not, there's still a cheat sheet in your pamphlet right here you can cheat off of. Man, how many teachers, when you guys were going to school, gave you a whole month to study for the test and gave you the answers in the middle of the pamphlet? No, nothing. Oh, is that yours? Oh, okay. All right, we got just a couple of announcements. Today is going to be a treat. Gibson Gellerman came back. He's going to bring forth the Word of God today. And if you came to hear the Word of God, you're in the right place. So thank you, Gibson, for coming back again and filling in for Rick. They will be back next week, it sounds like. So yeah, if you've been waiting for Rick, he'll be back. He promised he'll be back. He didn't quit forever. Just a couple of quick announcements. Street Smart Christian Youth Group is going to be starting back up in September. I'm thinking probably the first week in September, after all the kids are back in school, getting things going, we will kick off youth group again. And it sounds like we are going to do a Bible study from John MacArthur called The Fundamentals of Faith. We're going to go through that. That was one of the very first study books I ever did in my very first discipleship. And man, it was wonderful. So I think we're going to go through that book through youth group. And then it'll go on throughout the whole school year once again. Men's and women's evening Bible studies will start back up in September. I will let you know a hard date on that the closer we get to that. The ladies, though, they are relentless. They keep going all year long. They meet here Tuesday mornings at 8:30, and they're going through the book of Joshua, right? So, if you're looking for a Bible study, and you can make it at 8:30 in the morning on Tuesdays, right here at the church is the place to be for that. The second Saturday of the month, we will have men's breakfast. Men, join us for that. It's a great time to get together with like-minded Christian men and fellowship. We do a devotional through it. We have breakfast. We talk. It's an amazing time to get together, make some new friends. Come join us. It's a great time. That's the second Saturday of every month right here at the church at 8 in the morning. So join us for that if you would like. Other than that, they still have their couples Bible study. That is on Wednesdays at 6:30. Is that right? 6:30. Okay, there, I got the thumbs up. You can't keep switching seats, Cody. All right, 6:30. They are going through a Chip Ingram Bible study. Has anybody ever struggled with emotions in this room before? I guess you're out of luck, Cody. There's no need for the class. We can get right over there. Right, your son, right back there. If you want to join them for that couple's Bible studies for married couples, dating couples, or maybe you're just thinking about doing all of that, come join Trail and Cody 6:30 in the evening, Wednesday nights. That is also a potluck, is that right? So there will be food provided and there will be child care. Is that $10 a kid? Is that what it was? Is that what it is? Okay. $10, so hopefully you don't have 10 kids. Oh. $10 per child if you want, if you need child care, that will be provided. Wednesday nights, again, 6:30 p.m., join Cody and Trail. If you don't know who they are, they are the couple that's sitting in the back doing that. Are we doing the bridge today, Cody? So right after the worship team gets done and Linda sings her special, it's always a gift when Linda comes and sings us a special, so thank you, Linda, for doing that. Right after that, kids, you can run upstairs with Cody for the bridge, and then if you have kids that would like to go back to the children's church, that is open as well right after the worship service. So with that being said, I'm going to quit talking. We're all going to jump into our... What? He said yay. Okay. All right, Brent. Okay. All right. We're all going to jump into our memory verse, which was Psalms 121, 1 through 2. All right. I'll start it out. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. That was the July memory verse. And now we get to go into the August memory verse that we will recite every Sunday in August, is 1 Chronicles 29:11. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. That's an easy one, right? Well, you better start memorizing today. Because as of next week, wait, we're just going to pick people. I'm kidding. All right, guys, I'm going to give it back to the worship team. Thank you guys so much. We will see you next week.
All right, if you want to stand and join us again, we're going to continue on with some worship.
Surrender. forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. Conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of a risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of a risen King. Is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. He brought his mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of a risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You
sing our last song, All Who Are Thirsty.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Father, we just thank you for this glorious day that you've given us. And we invite you here. Please join us. Holy Spirit, be among us. You are our teacher. Help us, guide us, and direct us. And we just pray that you would be with Gibson as he brings forth your word. And we are so thankful he's not ashamed of the gospel. We're willing to share it with a nation that desperately needs it. Father, I just ask that you continue to be with Rick and Cheryl as they're out traveling and that they get the rest that they need, but you bring them back safely to us. Father, thank you for this family, for the love and the support, each one here. Father, for the family that's watching online too, you are part of our service and we are thankful for you too. Father, we just thank you for this time and for all things in Jesus' precious, powerful name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to have a special. Linda's going to come up and sing us a song.
Good morning. This song this morning is one that I just love it because Chris Christopherson wrote it, and it's amazing because it's called "Why Me, Lord?" And you know, when we go through trials in life, you're always like, oh, "Why me, Lord? Why do I have to go through this?" But none of us do anything to deserve the blessings that we get. And so, in turn, we should always think, well, why me, Lord? Why did I get to do that? Why did that happen to me? So basically, that's what this song is about.
Oh, Morning. There we go. Would you please pray once more with me? Father, we lift our eyes to the hills. From where does our help come from? Our help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And so, Lord, I ask now that you would come and that you would help, that the words that flow out of my mouth would be good and right in accord with your word, and that you would give us all hearts to seek and savor the supremacy of your Son in all things, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to start in Habakkuk chapter 1. That's a minor prophet. Habakkuk chapter 1. Habakkuk chapter 1, starting in verse 2. How long, O Yahweh, will I call for help, and you will not hear? I cry out to you, violence, yet you do not save. Why do you make me see wickedness and cause me to look on trouble? Indeed, devastation and violence are before me, and there is strife, and contention is lifted up. Therefore, the law is ignored, and justice never comes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, justice comes forth perverted. As far as been the reading of God's word. I wanted to start in Habakkuk 1, and I want to finish in Habakkuk chapter 3. And we will be all over the Bible today. I wanted to speak on the providence of the Lord. And I start with the complaint of the prophet, because in my experience, people do not truly understand or grasp the pervasiveness of God's providence until it is seen in their own life, in the trials and tribulations that they go through. When life is on the up and everything looks good, it's a little harder to acknowledge that the Lord is in control. But it becomes much easier when life is taken away from you. The prophet contends that the Lord does not hear, does not save, and idly looks at wrong, and that despite his prolonged cry, it appears that the Lord is distant. Hold your place there. We'll come back to it. And in the next 40, 50 minutes I have with you all, my goal is to have you leave here, go out, and when a friend or a family member or a stranger or colleague asks you, you believe that the Lord is in control. I want your answer to be yes. And then when they ask you, in control of what exactly? I want your joyful response to be of everything. God is in control of every rotation of the planet, every star that falls from the sky, every morning sunrise, earthquake, tsunami, car crash, famine, piece of bacon cooked in the morning, bullet shot, person killed, baby aborted, every marriage, every child that blesses that family, every breath of your lungs, every drop of rain, every particle of dust in the air, over the Olympics, insert literally anything, the Lord is in control and intimately in control of it. How do I get there? I want to first define what I mean when I talk about the providence of God. Secondly, I want to see if the Bible teaches that, and if it is as pervasive as I will make it out to be. Third, I want to show the purpose or end of the providence of God. And then finally, I want to give some implications and effects for our lives. First, the definition. The providence of God, broadly what I mean is that God works out all things. Not him working in all things as though things is a separate autonomous entity, but him working out of all things. Last week, I quoted a lot from Jonathan Edwards. This week, I'll quote a lot from Charles Spurgeon. I believe that every particle of dust that dances in the sunbeam does not move an atom more or less than God wishes. That every particle of spray that dashes against the steamboat has its orbit as well as the sun in the heavens. That the chaff from the hand of the winnower is steered as the stars in the courses. The creeping of an aphis over the rosebud is as much fixed as the march of the devastating pestilence. The fall of sear leaves from a poplar is as fully ordained as the tumbling of an avalanche. That's a sweeping statement that when God wishes for an avalanche to topple down a mountain, snow falls. Or when he wants a splash of water to hit a boat at a precise location, at a precise time, it happens just as he would have it to happen. Particles of dust do not deviate from exactly where God would have them to be. That's what I mean by the pervasiveness of the providence of God. Does the Bible teach that? Amen. I want to start with God's providence in our own lives, namely at the point of conversion. The state of natural man, the state of all unbelievers, is one of bondage to sin. Romans 8, for to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So you, when you're in your natural state, have no ability to please the Lord. 1 Corinthians 2:14. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. The man in bondage to a sin, who is a slave to sin, does not possess the ability to accept the things of the Lord or the Lord himself. Ephesians 2, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. It is God who quickens our spirits and makes us alive together with Christ. The state of our being before the Lord does that is characterized by death. There is nothing but rot and decay and deadness in our souls before the Lord comes and makes them alive. 2 Corinthians 4, for God who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. I love that verse. The God who created everything out of nothing, the God who said, let there be light, and there is light, that God shines the light of the gospel into your darkened heart. That is a sovereign act of the Lord. So then the question that comes to most minds is, how does God's providence interact with human willing? Proverbs 16:9, the heart of man plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. So planning is good. Be a planner. Love to plan. But understand, the steps that you take are from the Lord. Jeremiah 10:23, I know, O Lord, that the way of man is not in himself, that it is not in man who walks to direct his steps. So the steps that you took out of your car to walk in here and take your seat, those were of the Lord. Or Proverbs 21, the king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he will. The president's heart is a stream of water in the hand of God, that he can move to the right, to the left. He can take it up. He can take it downstream. Wherever it turns, one thing's for sure, and that it's the Lord turning it. Or Romans 9, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then, it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. Your salvation, not dependent on human willing or exertion, but on God who has been merciful to you. Most Christians struggle with that statement right there. And often what I do in trying to help them is ask them, if you were to stand before the Lord and he were to ask you, why do you have eternal life? The answer you could say is, well, because I believed in your son. And God would say, good, good. But why did you believe in my son and your friend or your family member did not? At that point, what is going to come out of your mouth is not going to be an answer in the first person. You will not say, because I did this, or because I chose this, or because I'm better or more holy in some fashion. That will not be your answer. The words that will flow out of your lips on that day when that question is asked is, because you, Lord, showed mercy upon me and passed over another. And that is God's sovereign right. What about God's providence in the realm of sin? Acts 4:27-28. For truly in this city, there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Jews who had shouted, crucify him, and the Gentiles gathering against Jesus did exactly what God would have them to do, namely, sin by crucifying the Lord of glory, which is the worst evil to have ever taken place, way more evil than a taking of a child or of a parent, because who died was the Son of God. And the text says that God brought that about. Or take the story of Joseph, sold into slavery, is accused of raping Potiphar's wife, and so he's thrown into jail. His bunkmate forgets about him for a few years until he finally remembers, and then Joseph rises to be essentially vice president of Egypt. And we come to the end of the book of Genesis, and we find this remarkable phrase. Genesis 50:20. As for you, he's speaking to his brothers, as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. The text does not say what you meant for evil, God used for good. It doesn't say that. God is not playing catch up with the people's sins, as though he's lagging behind the race and comes upon a sin and says, oh, I must bandage this one up now and fix it. That's not what the text teaches. The text says, what you meant for evil, God meant, same word, meant for good. So our brains are to have a category that says, God can sovereignly ordain evil and yet not be evil himself. What about God's providence over the suffering of his saints? 1 Peter 4:19. Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful creator while doing good. Or Deuteronomy 32, see now that I, even I am he, and there is no God beside me. I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand. Or Revelation 1:18, I died, and behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death. Or Acts 10, Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. Exodus 4, then the Lord said to him, who has made man's mouth? Who makes him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? So you see a blind man on the street, that's the Lord's doing right there for his own purposes. Or we can take a look at the book of Job, who was more righteous than any man. And Satan comes to God and says, of course he's more righteous. He has everything. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch out your hand. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and takes away Job's oxen, donkeys, servants, sheep, camels, and your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And behold, a great wind came across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young people, and they are dead. The response of Job, then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell to the ground and worshiped. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The killing of the livestock, the removal of his servants, and the loss of his own children, even though it says Satan went out, Job ascribes those to God. Some people say that he got it wrong. But we know that's not the case because of the next verse. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Or take the next peril in Job's life. Satan answered the Lord and said, skin for skin. All that a man has, he will give for his life. But stretch out your hand and touch him, bone in his flesh, and he will curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, he's in your hand, only spare his life. So Satan, the text says, Satan went out from the presence of the Lord, and Satan struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. His wife comes to him, says, you still hold fast to your integrity? Why don't you just curse God and die? Job said to her, you speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil? Sores, Job ascribes to God. Evil, Job ascribes to God. Suffering, he ascribes those to God as well. In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Job 42:11. And Job's brothers and sisters showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. What is the lesson to be learned in the book of Job? James 5:11. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. It is the Lord who afflicts his saints with evil, and yet the message of the book of Job is not that the Lord is evil, but that he is merciful and compassionate. That broadens our view of suffering so greatly. 2 Corinthians 4, we do not lose heart. For our light, momentary affliction is working out for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. So your suffering, your affliction is working for you. What about his providence over spirits? Mark 1:27, and they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." Jesus says to the demons, "Do this," and they do as they're told. The devil is on a leash. 1 Peter 3, Jesus has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels and authorities and powers having been subjected to him. What about God's providence over nature and more broadly over everything? Ephesians 1:11, in him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. Or Colossians 1, all things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Isaiah 46, I declare the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man of my counsel from a far country, I have spoken, and I will bring it to pass. I have purposed, and I will do it. You see a bird flying in the sky? That's the Lord right there. That's his purpose, fulfilling his word. Or a man coming in from afar? That's the Lord as well. Proverbs 16:33. The lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. So you're at home playing games with your family, and you roll 2 sixes, you say, praise the Lord. And I say, right, because it's the Lord who has decided that 2 sixes should show up on that dice. Every slot machine in Vegas winds up precisely where the Lord determines it to wind up. Psalm 135, whatever the Lord pleases, he does. In heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps, he it is who makes the clouds rise at the end of the earth, who makes lightnings for the rain and brings forth the wind from his storehouses. Or Psalm 115:3, our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. God hurled a great wind upon the sea and appointed a fish, Jonah 1. The Lord appointed a worm and a scorching east wind, Jonah 4. The Lord shut the lion's mouth, Daniel 6. The Lord will make the wolf dwell with the lamb and make the nursing child play over the hole of the cobra, Isaiah 11. The Lord appointed plagues on the nation of Egypt and killed all their firstborn. What about over weather? Psalm 107:25. For he commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea. Or Matthew 8:27, and the men marveled, saying, what sort of man is this? Even the winds and sea obey him. Psalm 148, praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures in all deeps, fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy wind fulfilling his word. You see a storm coming, you see the clouds gathering, that's God fulfilling his word. Psalm 105, God summoned a famine on the land. Famines, starvation come at the hand of God. God's providence is all throughout the Bible, stamped in, on, all around it. Spurgeon, his eye is at the bridal and at the funeral, at the cradle and at the grave. In the battle, God's eye is looking through the smoke. In the revolution, there is God's hand managing the masses of men who have broken loose from their rulers. In the earthquake, there is Jehovah manifest. In the tempest, there is God's hand tossing the bark, dashing it against the rocks, or saving it in his hand from the boisterous waves. in all seasons, at all times, in all dangers, and in all climates. There is the hand of God. What is the end result of the providence of God? Why is God working like this? Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace. So I would submit to you that what God aims at in the workings of providence is the display of his glory in the consummation of the joy of his bride being redeemed by Christ as he bears her sins in his body. That's a long, complex sentence. Let me read that for you again. What God aims at in the workings of providence is the display of his glory in the consummation of the joy of his bride being redeemed by Christ as he bears her sins in his body. In Ephesians 1, the predestination that takes place is before the foundation of the world through Jesus Christ to the praise of the glory of the grace of God. So, the result of predestination is not merely the glory of God. Rather, it is the praise of the glory of God, which is why I worded it. God aims to display his glory in the consummation of the joy of his people. I believe that C.S. Lewis was correct when he said that we praise that which we enjoy because praise completes our joy. It is its intended end, its consummation. It finishes our enjoyment of something. So God, in providence, displays his glory through his saints praising him, which is nothing more than the consummation of their joy in him. But why grace? Why glorious grace? Why not just glory? The predestination happens before the foundation of the world, and it happens through Jesus Christ, whom gives us redemption in his blood and forgiveness of our trespasses. That's amazing because redemption, forgiveness, Christ slain is all of there before existence. Before you existed, Christ was slain on the cross. And so the reason for your existence and for the providence of God is to display the glory of the grace of God. And the climax of that glory is found in Jesus Christ dying for the sins of his people so that they may be received into God's presence where there is fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. I quoted Jonathan Edwards last week saying, God, in seeking his glory, seeks the good of his creatures because the emanation of his glory implies the communicated excellency and happiness of his creatures. God is their good. Their excellency and happiness is nothing but the emanation and expression of God's glory. God, in seeking himself or himself diffused and expressed, seeks their glory and happiness. I love that quote. I've used it twice now. Because God is so satisfied with his own glory and his own joy that as a fountain, he overflows and streams of grace and joy come to us through which we receive, and God is glorified in the echo, its reverberation of our joy in him. What makes up that echo back to God is our satisfaction of who his son is to us. That's why I'm so passionate about the providence of God. It's everywhere. I love it. I want to give you 8 effects or implications of this pervasive providence. First, God's all-pervasive providence is the cure for all of the anxiety in your life. Matthew 6, Jesus says, "Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? If God provides for the birds, their food, and life is more than food, and you are worth more than the birds, why worry? You have no reason to worry. How insignificant is the single blade of grass that you pass by each day? And yet, the Lord clothes it. Will he not much more clothe you? One more Spurgeon quote. "You cannot banish me from my Lord. Send me to the snows of Siberia. I shall have the eyes of God there. Send me to Australia and let me toil at the gold diggings. There will he visit me. If you send me to the utmost verge of the round globe, I shall still have the eye of God upon me. Put me in the desert where there is not one single blade of grass growing, and his presence shall cheer me. Or let me go to sea amid the howlings of the tempest and the shrieking wind, where the mad waves lift up their voice to the skies as if they would pluck the stars from their cloudy thrones, and I shall have the eye of God there. Let me sink, and let my gurgling voice be heard among the waves. Let my body lie down in the caverns of the sea, and the eye of God shall be on every bone. And in the day of the resurrection shall my every atom be tracked in its wanderings. Yes, the eye of God is everywhere. Providence is universal." So wherever the Lord takes you in life, whether it be that you stay in Calhoun, Colorado for the rest of your life, or God calls you to go live in a shack and evangelize to Muslims or Hindus, what will bring comfort to your soul in those times is not the circumstances that you're in. What will bring comfort to the soul is that the Lord is the one who has put you there. The Lord is our portion. Secondly, acknowledging God's all-pervasive providence stops us from being arrogant. James 4, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, what you ought to say is, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. If the Lord wills, we will live. If the Lord wills, I will finish this sermon. If not, I'll drop dead or I'll faint. This or that. How much more pervasive could you get? You either do that or you do this. That's everything." Acknowledging that truth guards us from arrogance. Why do I say that? Because in the next verse, James says, "As it is," in other words, you're not doing this, "as it is, you boast in your arrogance." not acknowledging the pervasiveness of the providence of God in our lives brings about an arrogant heart. Thirdly, God's all-pervasive providence demands repentance. Luke 13, a group of people come to Jesus and are asking about this tower that has fallen over on people. And it's their assumption that the tower fell on them because the people were worse sinners. Jesus says, "Or those 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." I've always found that passage amazing because tower falls, people die, Jesus says, you need to repent now. There's no waiting. You repent now, otherwise you're going to die. So when someone asks me about the wars in the Middle East or about the atrocities in America and the abortion front, my message to them is, you need to repent right now. All of those things, all of those disasters, all of those deaths are signaling to you, you need to repent or you will likewise perish. Fourth, God's all-pervasive providence removes the fear of the things of this world. Matthew 10, 26 through 31. "So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them falls to the ground apart from your Father? But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows." Fear not is included three times in that text. Why? Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Not one of them falls to the ground apart from the Father's hand. So in the remotest part of the Amazon rainforest, a bird just falls down dead, splat on the ground, dies and decays. That's the Father's hand right there. He has numbered the hairs on your head. So do not fear the things of this world, but instead fear God. It has been said by many that you are invincible until the Lord is done with you on this earth. Fifth, God's all-pervasive providence leads to urgency in killing sin. Philippians 2, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For the grounding for working out your salvation with fear and trembling is for it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Or 1 Corinthians 15:10, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that was with me." So Paul had determined to work harder than anyone. Yet he knew that all of his works that he ever did were God's works. They weren't his works. It was God working in him. And the Lord's all-pervasive providence did not hinder Paul from working harder. Rather, it was the grounds on which his work was built. Sixth, God's all-pervasive providence leads to boldness in prayer and evangelism. It is a rather confusing objection that people bring to me and say, "Gib, if the Lord has governed all things as you make it out to be, why should I pray or why should I go evangelize? The Lord will just do it." And it's a confusing objection to me because it's like asking, Gib, if you were ordained to preach this sermon at Living Word Community Church in Callahan, Colorado on this day, why drive there? Or it's like asking, if the Lord decreed that I was to eat a cookie at lunch, why would you pick it up and lift it to your mouth? Or if the Lord determined that a wide receiver catch a pass, why should the quarterback throw it? Now, the answer to all those bluntly ridiculous questions is that without driving, I wouldn't be here. Or without picking up a cookie, I couldn't eat it. Or without throwing, nobody could catch a ball. And my answer is that without evangelism and prayer, no one is saved. 1 Peter, you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. Born again by the word of God. And then he says, and this word is the good news that was preached to you. Or it was the gospel that was preached to you. So in other words, yes, God determines who will be saved. But God also determined that evangelism and prayer would be the means through which they are saved. No one is saved apart from evangelism. And I have found when I go out and do homeless ministry, usually weekly, there is absolutely no way that I could go do that without believing everything that I've said here. I would have no confidence that the Lord could save a soul that I talk to. Seventh, God's all-pervasive providence secures all of God's promises. The whole earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. That is a huge promise. The knowledge of the glory of the Lord is going to be everywhere. Or Isaiah 35:10. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. That's pretty cool. And that's going to happen. He who providentially brought about the slaughter of the Lamb of God, how will he not also with him providentially and graciously give us all that he has promised? Providence of the Lord is the foundation for God accomplishing his purposes and promises to us. Eighth, finally, God's all-pervasive providence leads to our rejoicing in all circumstances. Return to Habakkuk with me. We've heard of the complaint of the prophet. No, look at verse 5. Verse 5 starts the Lord's answer to the prophet. He says to Habakkuk, "See among the nations and look. Be also astonished, be astounded, because I am doing something in your days you would not even believe if told." The answer that the Lord gives to the prophet who raises his complaints is, "I am working. I am doing something that you would not even believe." Why does that relate to our rejoicing? God's working out of all things, his providence, provides the foundation for what Habakkuk says in chapter 3, verses 17 through 18, which are verses I have quoted to myself more than anything in the Bible. These are precious. "Though the fig tree should not blossom, and there be no produce on the vines, though the yield of the olive should fail, and the field yield no produce, though the flock should be cut off from the fold, and there be no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation." So perhaps consider next time that you walk through a struggle or a trial in life, that in order for a flower to grow and bloom, the Lord must first send his pouring rains upon it. Or, if it is time for the flower to move to a different location, the Lord may send a gust of wind to move it. Or, if it is time for the flower to die, the Lord may send a scorching heat to wither its leaf. Perhaps in the sea that is the providence of the Lord, it is at times necessary for him to batter the boat and send his waves and breakers to bring the boat to his eternal shores. I close with the words of William Cooper. God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. Judge not the Lord by feeble sense, but trust him for his grace. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a smiling face. Let us pray. Father, I ask that you would bring justice on the wicked and grant repentance to this nation, and that you would be our God and you would help us to be a people that so enjoy your providential hand that we may say with our whole souls that though the fig tree should not blossom and there be no cattle in the stalls, yet we will rejoice in you and take joy in you, the God of our salvation. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.